Good day, this is Jim Pytel from Columbia Gorge Community College. This is Digital Electronics. This lecture is entitled Synchronous Counters. From our previous discussion of asynchronous counters, we've kind of discovered a fatal flaw to them, namely, because of the propagation delay, it ripples through those series of counting devices, and the delays get worse and worse for those higher order sequential devices. And as a result, certain glitch states can develop, which affect the operation of your counter. So the synchronous counter solves that problem by clocking everything together. And it's really neat because these devices change states simultaneously because they're all being fed that same clock. We talked about a propagation delay in our asynchronous counters, and what's really neat is the synchronous counter has a propagation delay, and it is measurable. However, it's actually fundamental to the operation of these devices. You're actually using the propagation delay to your advantage to get these things to work. Besides the fact I'm calling this lecture synchronous counters, and I've got the word synchronous counters written over this device, what would make you think it's a synchronous counter? The answer is the clock. They're all tied together. I have not put the stage logic for the J's and K's on this. We will put that in there later. And what I've previously limited this discussion of synchronous counters to is there is logic on the J and K inputs to set, reset, stay, or toggle when necessary to initiate an up sequence, a down sequence, or whatever sequence you wish. So let's go ahead and add some logic now to the J's and K's. And kind of fundamental to this understanding is, what does a flip-flop do when J is 0 and K is 0? The answer is it stays. What does a flip-flop do when J is 1 and K is 1? The answer is it toggles. It goes to its opposite state. And if we want to go ahead and do so, what does it do when J is 1, K is 0? It sets. What do we do when J is 0, K is 1? It resets. So it helps to have that little truth table for a JK flip-flops modes available. And that's our little truth table right there. For these particular examples here, we're only going to be using the memory and the toggle state. The J's and K's are both zeros. They're going to be in a memory state. It's going to stay the same. If the J's and K's are both one, they'll toggle to go to their opposite state. Okay, so let's go ahead and put some logic on there. Okay, what I've drawn here is a 3-bit binary counter with some inputs. What is the J0 and K0 input? Well, it's constantly a 1, so that is constantly toggling. What's the J1, K1 inputs? Well, it's Q0. Notice the clock. The clock is still being fed to that second stage counting device. However, the J's and K's, it's the Q0. What is the J and K input for the MSB stage? Well, it's Q1 and Q0. Okay, so it will toggle when Q1 and Q0. Basically, both of them need to be high for that final MSB to go ahead and toggle. So let's just go ahead and do a quick analysis of Q0. And just let's pretend Q2. Q1 and Q0 are 0. And Q0 is basically exactly like we've done for an asynchronous counter. What's it do? Every single positive edge, it toggles, but there's a measurable propagation delay. So Q0 is a 0, goes along. In a perfect world, it would toggle right there. It doesn't. There's a propagation delay, so it toggles right there. And every single positive edge, it does that. Ordinarily there, slight delay, toggles. Okay, so let's go ahead and finish up Q0, and that's exactly what Q0 does. And again, we're accounting for those slight propagation delays because of those positive edges. It takes some time for that positive edge to ripple, to go to that output. Now, Q1. Q1 is still acting on the positive edge of the clock, because that's when it's looking for its trigger. However, it will toggle only when Q0 is high. And this is what I say, it makes use of the propagation delay. At this moment, at this positive edge here, what's the value of Q0? Well, it's 0. It's going to stay. At this positive edge right here, what's the value of Q0? It's 1. It toggles there, however, with a measurable propagation delay. Again, what happens here at this moment, at this positive edge, Q0 is a 0. It's going to stay the same. However, at this edge, Q0 is a 1. It will toggle right there with a measurable propagation delay. Okay, so Q1 is going to look something like this. And there might be some inaccuracies due to my handwriting, but what's occurring here is, although there is a delay in Q0 and although there is a delay in Q1, they are changing simultaneously because that delay is the same. They're identical devices. So there is no, the LSB is not changing before the next higher bit. So now look at from the perspective of Q2. It will toggle when both Q1 and Q0 are high. And just go right to it. Where are they both high? Well, right there at that positive edge. Where else? Right there, at that positive edge, right there, at that positive edge. So this is pretty neat. We're actually making use of those propagation delays, those measurable propagation delays, to go ahead and get these things to toggle when we want to. What does Q2 look like? It toggles at that moment with a slight delay, at that moment with a slight delay, at that moment with a slight delay. What have we developed? We've developed a 3-bit up counter. We're going from 000 to 1 to 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, at which point we go ahead and recycle to 000. And what's really neat about this is everybody's occurring, the transitions are occurring simultaneously because they're all being clocked together. What would happen if I added a 4th bit position to this, i.e. a 4th MSB flip-flop that is also clocked together that happened to have the inputs for its J and K inputs as Q1 and Q0 and Q2. Basically, when all three of these are high, what would happen? You can kind of guess what's happening here, guys. I'm counting up in a binary sequence. I mean, just look at a binary sequence. I'll go ahead and write one out. So here's our 4-bit binary sequence written from MSB to LSB. Well, when is the LSB toggling? It's always toggling, okay? It's constantly going from 0 to 1. When does the next stage, i.e. Q1, toggle? Well, when that previous one was a 1. So look at here. It's going from 0 to 1, 0 to 1. When does that occur? When there's a 1 on the previous stage. Okay, now let's go ahead and look at from the perspective of Q2. Okay, when does it toggle? Well, it occurs right there, right there. So it's going from a block of zeros to a block of ones. When does it occur? When those previous stages are both 1. When those previous stages are both 1. Previous lower stages are 1. Let's look at it from the perspective of Q3. Okay, Q3, it was a 0. Big old block of zeros. Then it toggles up to a 1. When does it do the toggling? When the previous stages are 1. And if we were to extend this count sequence into another block of 8, it would be recycling. When does that toggle? When all previous stages, previous lower stages are 1. I'm not expecting you to design these right now, but if I give you this, you should be able to go ahead and figure this out. And here's a 4-bit binary counter. You can go ahead and try this. So here's our blank timing diagram. And I know that I could have drawn J0 and K0 hooked to a +5. And I know that I could have drawn Q0 going into J1, K1. But now look at, J2, K2. I've got Q1 and Q0. I'd have to draw an AND gate in there. J3, K3, I'd have to draw a 3-input AND gate. Just realize for now, I could draw those logic gates. It's just going to get super messy. This is what I recommend, is definitely put those logic expressions on the outside, just to simplify your diagram. Let's go ahead and look at Q0. What is Q0 going to do? Well, it's constantly toggling. It will toggle anytime the clock has a positive edge with a measurable propagation delay. Okay, so that's exactly what Q0 looks like. What is Q1 going to do? Well, it's going to still toggle on the positive edges of that clock, because again, that's its trigger input, but it will only toggle when Q0 is a 1. At what time does that occur? Right there, here, right here, and so on. Okay, let's go ahead and look at how Q1 behaves. Okay, so far so good. Q0 and Q1 behaving exactly like they've done previously. And guess what Q2 is going to do? It's going to behave exactly like we had in our previous counter. It's going to go ahead and toggle when both Q1 and Q0 are 1 and a positive edge occurs. I'm seeing one right here, one right there. And go ahead and find the others and go ahead and see what Q2 looks like. There you go. There may be some inaccuracies due to my handwriting, however, but what I'm trying to get across to you is the fact that these things are occurring simultaneously. Okay, there is no glitch state. Although there is a propagation delay, everyone has the same propagation delay. Okay, finally, Q3. It will toggle when all previous stages, Q2, Q1, and Q0, are 1 at a positive edge. Where do you see that? I see one right here, and I see another one right there. So Q3, let's say it was a 0. It's going to go on and stay a 0 until that positive edge. However, with a minor propagation delay, it'll toggle at that moment. It will toggle at this positive edge with a minor propagation delay, and we're going to go all the way back. So what have we created? We've created a full sequence 4-bit binary up counter, because we've gone from, at this moment, quadruple 0, all the way through our full sequence of 1, 1, 1, 1. Kind of doing exactly what that truth table did. Look at Q0, it's every other. Look at Q1, it's every 2. Look at Q2, it's every 4. Look at Q3, it's every 8. Okay? Now, let's add a little bit of complexity to this. J0 and K0, it's constantly toggling. Let's add some other inputs to the J1s, K1s, J2, K2s, J3, K3. And what's crazy about this next counter that I showed you, it's going to use previous stages, i.e. MSB stages, to affect the lower stages. Okay, so this is one of those chicken or the egg things. And this is going to be hard to do because you have to do it in a step-by-step fashion. And you can't just make a blanket statement across these truth tables like we've done thus far. So let's go ahead and try this one. Okay, so here's a slightly tougher example of a synchronous counter. Notice I have not drawn the logical inputs on those J and K stages. What I've done is put them over here. The reason why I didn't draw them, it'd be kind of a mess. And if you're ever presented with one of these things where there are logic gates feeding these things, I highly recommend you just go ahead and take the expressions for J1 and K1 and J2 and K2 and so on and so forth, and just writing them out and having them handily available off to the side. I could put the logic gates in there, but it's just going to be a mess. This is not so easy. The reason why it's not so easy is because we have to go count by count to evaluate the expressions. The only one that's constant is Q0, i.e. the LSB stage. That one constantly toggles. This one constantly toggles, and we can say with surety that Q0 will constantly go from 0 to 1, 0 to 1, 0 to 1, every single positive edge. Q1, Q2, and Q3, however, can't really say that because look at the inputs for J1 and K1. Well, it's taking the MSB stage, Q3. In this particular case, it's not Q3. Look at the inputs for J3 and K3. It's taking all the lower inputs, Q2 and Q1 and Q0, or Q3 and Q0. So it's basically, it's feeding back its own present state to it. So this is a very, very complicated example because you have to step through every single positive edge. I'm going to shortcut a little bit of this right now, and you can do this for every single one of these. What I'm going to do is I'm going to go from 0 to 8, okay, and then some magic is going to occur here. Okay, so just trust me, and you can come back and do these things later if you wish. We're going to go from 0 to 1 to 2 to 3 to 4 to 5 to 6 to 7. Finally, we've made the transition to 8, and we're safe up until this positive edge right here. And this is what I'm saying. You've got to do it for every single positive edge. At that positive edge right there, evaluate the expressions for every single one of those. What I'm saying is what is J1, comma, K1? Because they're getting the same evaluations. What is the value for J2, K2? What is the evaluations for J3, K3? Given that current state of inputs right there, okay, what's the expression for J1, K1? Well, it's not Q3 and Q0. Okay, so Q3 is a 1, not Q0 is a 0. How do we get there? Our total expression should be 0. So it sounds like J1, K1, it's in a memory state. So what is Q1 going to do? It's going to stay 0. Evaluate the expressions for J2 and K2. Okay, well, it's Q1 and Q0. Q1 and Q0. Q1 is a 0. Q0 is a 0. So it sounds like that particular stage is also going to be in a memory state. What is that going to do? It's going to stay a 0 up until the next positive edge. Q3, what is its expression? Its expression is the big one, Q2 and Q1 and Q0, or Q3 and Q0. What are the values? Well, at that edge, Q2 is a 0, Q1's a 0, Q0 is a 0, Q3 is a 1, Q0 is a 0. So that whole expression is going to be evaluated as a 0. So what is it going to do? It's going to stay the same. Okay, so you already see what a pain this is here. Now let's reevaluate this here. This is what where the magic happens. What are the inputs for every single one of these? Now, are we in toggle state? Are we in memory state? Let's go ahead and clear out those. So at that particular positive edge right there, we've got Q3 is a 1, Q2 is a 0, Q1 is a 0, Q0 is a 1. And now go ahead and fill those particular expressions in. Okay, so those are our evaluations based on those current inputs at that positive edge. And notice what's happening here. Q1 is going to stay. Q2 is going to stay. Here's something neat. Q3, it will toggle based upon those present inputs. That thing goes back down to a 0. All the other ones stay where they were. Where are we back to? We're back to a state of 0. Okay, because again, we went back to here. We're right back to quadruple 0. What have we created with this thing? It's a 0 to 9 counter. So we started at 0. We went up to 1. We went up to 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Then we get up to 8, where we started our analysis. Then we get to 9, we're back to zero, and we start the whole count sequence again. I'm not expecting to design the things at this point right now. And again, notice it was kind of a pain to do this. We had to do this every single clock edge. Look how many clock edges it took to do that. Could you imagine how hard the analysis of something like this would be? I'm going to show you a quicker, easier tabular approach, which we'll discuss a little bit later for analysis of synchronous counters. But for right now, the big take-home point of the synchronous counters is they're all clocked together. Look at, and I know there's some inaccuracies due to my handwriting, these things are occurring simultaneously. There is no glitch state that occurs. Okay, it's that perfect simultaneous transition. Why? Because everybody has the same delay. They're identical devices. This concludes this portion of the synchronous counters lecture. One brief moment here is, remember how we previously used asynchronous counters? We used those clear inputs and we had to have that glitch state too at the end where you had to go to the next count sequence. How do we do this in synchronous counters? Not only were we eliminating the glitches within that count sequence, we were actually eliminating that potential glitch state at the end where you have to go into that next highest sequence to effectively clear out these counters. Okay, this actually really does conclude the synchronous counters lecture. We'll go ahead and do some analysis of synchronous counters, including that tabular method I discussed previously, and discuss some fixed function integrated circuit synchronous counters.